begin, that's good. I can give you time if you want.
Okay, sure.
10 minutes, 5 minutes? Or?
5 minutes, yes.
All right, so we'll give you 5 minutes.
Okay. Yeah, have a seat. Okay, I think it's about time to start. Good morning, everybody. I know today is a quiet morning, so I hope you enjoy it. Okay, what I'm going to talk about is the state of NUMA support within the Linux kernel. For NUMA, what I'm talking about is the fact that as the number of CPU or number of core in a socket keep increasing, right now with Intel, the maximum number of CPU or maximum number of core per socket is 28, and for AMD it's now up to 32. So if we put more socket on the system, we are getting more and more core. And with SMT, you have 2 threads per core, so you double the number of threads. For instance, in the case of, as far as I know, HPE, the Superdome X system, can support up to 32 socket, though the biggest one you can buy right now is probably about 16 socket. But still, you can't the maximum config. With 32 socket, you can have up to 896 core, and that translates to 1,792 threads per system. So with such massive number of core and threads on the system, and with multiple different socket, the application has to be aware of where the NUMA nature of a system in order to fully utilize it. In fact, with such a big system, you may not be even able to put up the Linux kernel without problem. That problem, I think, is largely solved with the recent changes in the locking subsystem to make it easier to support such a larger configuration. And in this presentation, I will talk about three major challenges that we have in order to for the applications for the Linux kernel to support such a large system. The first one is data locality, and then I'll talk a little bit about heap pages, and finally we'll talk about cache line contention. So what is NUMA? NUMA basically is a way of design system that instead of because in the older time, you have a shared bus where all the CPU communicate via the shared bus, and the memory is attached to a shared bus. But this has changed in the last few decades to a NUMA configuration where each socket have their own local memory. Different memory, depending on where it is put, have different pathway to all the other CPU. That means different access time. And the reason for that is simply because of performance. Because with shared bus, everything put on the same shared bus, then it will limit the frequency and the speed with which you can access those information. But on a dedicated bus on each of socket, transaction can be done much quicker. But the downside is if you need to access a remote data that are far away on another node, it will take a longer time. So. In this talk, I will use some term that I want to define here to make sure they understand what I'm talking about. A socket refers to a physical process chip that are on a given processor socket. So, and a node refers to an entity that contains a CPU with local memory attached. And that is connected to all the other nodes via interposer transportation link, like the hypertransport or quick path. The two terms are not the same because you can have more than one node within a single socket. But usually, each socket is just one node. But there are cases, there are CPU that may not be true. An example would be the AMD EPYC CPU. It's actually four chips on a single socket. So you actually, if you take out the lid of the CPU, you will see four pieces of separate silicon on the same substrate. And they are connected by the interprocessor link, and then each of the chip connect to their own memory channel. So that's why in the case of the EPYC CPU, or one single socket is actually equal to four nodes, not one. And a core refer to a physical CPU with their own L1 and L2 cache. And L3 cache are usually shared among different cores. But L1 and L2 are dedicated to each of the core. And a FAT or logical CPU refer to an instruction stream that from the operating system point of view is one single CPU. We sometimes call it just a logical CPU because it's not exactly the same as one core. In the case of the 86, we support up to two FAT per core. For other architecture, they may support four or sometimes even eight. I know that the Power PC, I think the Power 8 can support up to 8 thread per core. But it is a setting that you can select, I think, on the BIOS level. Whether you can select four thread per core or 8 thread. The more thread you select, the slower each thread will be, basically. Okay, data locality. For maximum performance, you would like to have all your data needed by the application to be in the same node that attached to the CPU in the same node without going through the interprocessor link to a remote node. The reason is that within the same node, the access time are usually much quicker and for some of the benchmark that we run, if the data are on for memory intensive benchmark, if the data are on a local node, the speed can be up to 3 times faster than if the data are on a remote node. And if you have one or you install some of the enterprise applications like the Oracle database, they have many nodes to control their behavior, and many of the tuning nodes are actually for controlling the data locality. And another thing is that the scheduler in the Linux kernel will try to move tasks around to balance the load. So if most of the tasks are running on one node, but the other node are idle, the scheduler may move some of the tasks from one node to the other node in order to balance the load. But the side effect of that is the data that were once local will not become remote. So there are two ways you can control about this kind of movement or migration between nodes. Within the Linux kernel have a feature called Auto NUMA that when you turn it on, it will allow the kernel in its best effort try to move the data with the task as much as possible. So if the scheduler designed to move the task from one node to another node, it will also try to move the data accessed by that task to the other node as well in a best effort basis. But another way, because of that, because of the automatic nature, it may not be the best in terms of performance, because if you can manually control where the task and the data is, the performance are usually better than relying on the auto NUMA feature. And that's why for most enterprise applications, that they, when they have a large developer team to support it, they can tune the application much better than what can be done by the Linux kernel itself. But that require experience and expertise, so if we don't have a large support group to manage and tune the application, you may not get as good performance as another group or another organization that have a bigger support staff to do this kind of tuning. And for instance, if you have a phone system, you can run a single instance, single database instance on all the node, or you can separate into four separate instance and run each of the instance in one of the node, each of the node exclusively. You will find out that the four instance one will perform much better than the one instance, one database instance, because of the data locality problem. So depending on your use case, you may opt to have a multiple instance database instead of a single instance on all the node. Another issue that we found on tuning system on NUMA is the hill pages. All modern open system use virtual memory that translate virtual address to physical address. And the translation is done via a page table. In the case of 86, the page table is four level for current core of CPU. The new one that are coming, I think next year, Ice Lake, you have five level page table and support up to 52-bit of physical memory. Right now, we only support up to 46-bit of physical memory, which translates to 64 terabyte. But in the future, we will support up to 4 gigabyte of memory with five-level page table. For 86, a page can be either 4K, 2 meg, or even 1 gigabyte. But then, in order to speed up the translation process, there's a kind of cache within the CPU called the TLB, translation look-aside buffer, that are used to cache all these virtual to physical translation, so that if you use an address that are already in the cache, it can immediately give you back the actual physical address to go there to fetch the data item instead of going through the translation process again, because the translation itself, you have to access four separate page tables, so you have four additional memory access, which of course slow things down for everything that the computer is doing. But there are a limit on how large the TLB can be. So you can't have too many entry in the TLB. And because of that, if the application have a large data set, that means it tries to access memory from many different locations, it's possible that you run out of the cache in the TLB, and then if that's the case, you will flush the least recent use TLB entry, and then do the translation, load the new mapping into the TLB, and so that will slow things down pretty significantly. So in order to allow the TLB to cover a larger address space, you will need to use hill pages. Again, the kernel provide two mechanisms for you to utilize the hill page. The first one is transparent hill page. With that, the kernel manage the hill page for you. So it will look the data page that you load in. It use 4K page by default, but if you saw that you are accessing quite a number of 4K pages within a bigger 2 mega page, it will combine the smaller 4K pages together into a 2 mega page and use one entry in the TLB instead. But then if you try to deallocate memory that within the hill page, the kernel will have to break it up back to the individual 4K pages, so there are some overhead involved. Another way to manage huge page is using what they call the huge TLB FS file system, in which is the application job to manage the heal page. The application tell the operating system which memory address I want to use this page. And so the kernel would then map those memory address with heal page directly, and it won't pick it up and it won't do other stuff. So on the kernel side, it's much easier because it just follow what the application asks them to do. But then the application have to know what they are doing. If they don't use the heal page correctly, it can hinder performance because with the heal page, you don't use up all the memory in the heal pages. You are just wasting memory, and so. In fact, many enterprise applications, they recommend that you turn off TLB because they can do a better job than TLB by using heal page directly. And having TLB is just adding some extra overhead to slow things down. That's why they sometimes recommend turning off TLP and let them handle the huge pay. Another thing I want to talk about is the cache line contention. And before talking about cache line contention, I would like to talk a little bit about the cache coherency protocol. Within a modern CPU, we usually have three levels of caches. There are some exotic CPU that may have up to four levels. I know that for some of the big IBM PowerPC system, they have a multi-chip module, like the Ryzen K. They have maybe two chips on a socket, and then there will be a third one, the first chip of memory, they have a level four cache. In most commercial CPU, is only three level of cache. And if you have a NUMA system with multiple socket, we need to make sure that the content of the cache are consistent. So if one cache line is being accessed by multiple socket, they have to be the same. If they are different, the program will not behave correctly. And a cache line, in the case of 86, it's about 64 byte. There are some systems that would 120 byte cache line, but this day I think most of them use 64 byte as the size of the cache line. Most cache coherency protocols support four or five different states. In the case of Intel CPU, they use the MESIF, the Modified Exclusive Shared Inverter and Foil protocol. AMD uses a slightly different one, but the principle is about the same. When multiple CPU are trying to access the same cache line across multiple nodes, the cache coherency protocol will make sure that the content of the cache stay consistent. Of the coherency protocol, one thing I want to let you aware that you try to do a write on the cache line. What happens is if a cache line is being shared by multiple nodes, when you do a write, it will have to, the cache coherency protocol will have to send an invalidate message to all the other nodes to invalidate the cache line there. And then only one node can have exclusive access to the cache line. And once it stays changed to exclusive, then you can write to the cache line. And so if you have multiple nodes trying to write to cache line, you create a situation that the ownership of cache line move around different nodes, a situation what we call the cache line bouncing, and that use up quite a lot of bandwidth in the interprocessor in the interprocessor link. And so that will limit the bandwidth available for other type of memory access and also increase the latency. Now, talking about cache line contention, usually on a large NUMA system with multiple nodes, cache line contention can be a serious performance bottleneck. There are two types of cache line contention that we usually talk about. The first type is called the forced cache line sharing. It's the case that multiple CPU, or maybe multiple sockets, try to access different data item, but they happen to be in the same cache line. And in that case, you will create a cache line contention problem. So CPU1 will try to access data item A, CPU2 access data item B. They are different data, but they're in the same cache line. And when they try to modify the value, you will create a problem. False cache line sharing can usually has to be solved. We have tools available to pinpoint this kind of problem, like the perp C2C tools. It will pinpoint where the cache line contention happened, and you can look at the address where the shared data is. If the address are different, that means they're actually different data items, but just happen to be in the same cache line. I mean, the address is different within the same cache line, then you know that these are false cache line sharing, and what you can do is try to move the data away so that they are in their own cache line instead of being shared together in the same cache line. So some tuning in your application in order to move them away from each other. Mm-hmm. In the Linux kernel, the data items that are mostly to be contained by multiple CPU are log and counter. Many counters in Linux have been switched to use per CPU counter. That means there is multiple counters, one for each of the CPU. They are counting the same thing. So when you want to look at the value of the count, when you do read from a sysfs variable or from a popfs variable that contain the counter data, what the kernel do is they sum up all the counter for each of the per CPU. They sum up all the counter for each of the CPU in order to give you the final result. But usually we are less frequently done than write. So the use of per CPU counter will avoid the cache line contention problem, but at the same time allow you to occasionally read the counter value. Without introducing other kind of contention. Another data type that have frequent cache line contention problem is the log. Log contention will slow things down because in the case of exclusive log, you have to only one CPU can own the log. The rest have to wait for it. So you basically seal your application at the log contention point. The level of log contention can be reduced by picking up a core screen log into multiple finite grain one. But in many cases, it's actually harder done than said. It may not be, depending on the kind of log it is, it may not be easy to break up into a smaller one. And another side effect of, and for log, there are two types of log, there are spinning log and sleeping log. In the case of spinning log, when there is a contention, it also means that the CPU will be spinning on the log cache line, and that causes a cache line contention problem that I talked about previously. And log contention used to be a serious problem. In fact, when I began working on Linux, my job is to try to improve the performance of application on large NUMA system. The first system that I work on have eight socket, and we see the effect of log contention is detrimental to performance on those kind of large system. So we try to work on the log itself to make the log contention less a serious problem. And I can say that we have largely solved this kind of log cache line contention problem by avoid spinning on the log cache line. If you have multiple waiter waiting on a log in the past, it used to just, they all spin on a log cache line to see when they are available. But today, only one or two, only the, yeah, only one of the waiter will spin on the lock. The rest will spin on their own local cache line, thus avoiding this kind of lock cache line congestion problem. A major building block in the locking infrastructure in the recent year is the use of the MCS lock. It's a locking algorithm that allows scalable lock synchronization in SMP system, and slightly different variants of MCS lock are used internally by the different lock in the kernel. The Q-spin lock is a new locking algorithm that was merged into the 4.2 kernel. With Q-spin lock, lock waiter are put into the MCS queue. The MCS itself serves as a like a queue, so you have a queue head and then a queue tail. Any newcomer will go into a queue tail and wait in the queue. And then the queue head will spin on the lock cache line, but the rest are spin on the local cache line, so there won't be too much contention on the lock cache line. And then we have QVA lock in the kernel, which was merged earlier in the v16 kernel. With the QVA lock actually is a fair lock. The previous version of the VVA lock code is an unfair lock, and unfair lock have the problem that if there is a lot of contention, it's possible that some of the CPU may never get the lock, or those CPU may have to wait a long time to get the lock. And in fact, one of the main problems of booting up large system with many CPU is that some of the CPU may never get a VWrite lock, and the most commonly used VWrite lock in the kernel is the task list lock. And in the boot-up process, the task list lock is quite contented because you have to spawn up a lot of kernel thread and a lot of user thread. And so it is possible that in the boot-up process, some of CPU, because they can't get the lock within, let's say, 73 seconds, you will have a soft lock message printing in the kernel. And in some case, they even have a hard lock up and crash the system. With QVA lock, is a fair lock, and when combined with the Q-spin lock, it will provide a fair VWrite lock without lock cache line congestion problem. And then for Mutex, which is sleeping mutually exclusive lock, in the past, lock waiter are allowed to spin on lock as long as the lock owner is running. So you actually look at the state of lock owner. If lock owner is running, it will spin on lock. Before the V10 kernel, the spinning is done just so everybody that are waiting on lock will spin on lock cache line. So we have the same lock cache line congestion problem. And in the V10 kernel, the patch is merged to make the waiting queue based on the MCS lock. That means only the queue head will spin on the lock. The rest, again, spin on their own cache line. And this solves the lock cache line congestion problem. And the Q-long code has since been enhanced and extracted into what we call optimistic spinning queue code in the kernel. They are now shared by also reverse semaphore. And around the, I think maybe 3.15 or 14 time frame, it was found that when they convert some of the Mutex into VWrite semaphore, the performance actually deteriorate because VWrite semaphore doesn't have the optimistic spinning code, and so they also adopt the optimistic. The use of the optimistic spinning queue since the v16 kernel in order to achieve performance parity with the Mutex. Now, I just want to show you some data that I have about the effect of lock cache line contention. The following two graphs will show you the locking rate of a micro benchmark using both the queue spin lock and the ticket spin lock. Is running on a 16 socket, 240 core IFPH EX system. So the Y axis shows you the number of operations per second, and the X axis is the number of core or number of active thread that are spinning, contending on the log. You can see that with the Q spin log, the performance kind of stabilized around more or less the same value. And in the case of ticket log, it actually deteriorates because of the increasing log contention. And you will see a drop here. It's because it's transitioning from only in a single node to a second node. So because there are 15 CPU on the socket, so up to here is within one socket. But once you go to the six, have 16 fat, then the extra fat come from a second socket, and that causes a deterioration in performance in both Q-spin log and the ticket log. It's just because there are a lot bigger latency involved in the acquisition of log. And this is this extends the y-axis up to all the CPU, all the core in the system. So you can see that if all the core in that system are spinning on the same log, ticket spin log, the locking rate will be down here, and for Q spin log is up here. It's about 4 to 5x difference, I think. So you can see clearly see that with log cache size contention, there will be a serious performance impact.
I'm sorry, what is the vertical axis? What does that represent?
It's just the number of locking operations per second. So the binary benchmark is just acquire a log, release it, and then acquire again repeatedly. And it shows you how many such operations you can done by all the thread on the system.
Higher is better.
Higher is better, yes. Okay, conclusion. So the Linux kernel is doing a pretty good job in managing data locality itself for its own data structure. So, but for application, they have to know how to manage it properly. Otherwise, they can't utilize all the NUMA nodes within the NUMA system. For application that are not NUMA aware, then what we can do is we can use some tools like NUMA control or CPU set in C group to limit application to one on just one node or a number of CPU within a single node. They will largely solve the data locality problem. And work is still ongoing on the transparent HP side to make it more useful for the FH user. That will take quite a while for the improvement to come. So I would expect that in the next few years, we are still working on transparent HP pages. And cache size contention is still an ongoing problem. There are many code in the kernel, and depending on workloads, some contention problem may show up, which we need to address once it is found. But log cache size contention, however, I think is mostly solved. Though we still are doing some additional tuning and performance enhancement in the logging code. Okay, that ends my presentation. So, you have any question? Yeah, I think it's time. Okay.
Maybe one question, but no, I don't think
we have
time.
Just,
yeah.
So, are there currently, you mentioned some valve tools to do some measurements. Are there some, for instance, off-chip counters that would give you an idea of how much latency you have for memory accesses, for unit process, this kind of thing? Is that something that is easy to measure today?
Could you repeat the question?
The question is, I talked about a perp tool to diagnose the application in order to find out if there are any cache line contention. The perp tool is the most common one that I use. I know there are other third-party tools out there also can do this kind of measurement, like the Intel V-Tune. And
but my question was, I think your tool, the tool you mentioned was specifically about mostly the local cache. And my question was whether there was a way to measure the fraction of your memory accesses that were going to some other NUMA node and the latency that you got from that.
Actually, the tools will show you I think it will show you the latency to on different NUMA node. So the output of perp 2TC is very wide, and it will show you on each node how many hit you have on each of the node. So you will know that how much access are remote, how much are local. So I would highly recommend you try out the perp 2TC if you are interested in this kind of problem.
And this is the kind of measurements that Autonuma uses, or is it something else?
You just do, just like a regular perf, do a record for a certain period of time, and then you will generate a report on all this cache line, the memory access pattern that exceed a certain threshold, and so you can. I would highly recommend you try it out and see whether you like it or not. Okay, thank you very much for your time.